All right. Hello and welcome everyone to the second of our series of lectures at the Courtyard Clinic. Today we're going to talk about HIV, recreational drugs, and chem sex. My name is Mark Pakianathan, and I'm one of the doctors that's based here at the Courtyard Clinic. And increasingly we are seeing some of our patients presenting with a chem sex related problem or a drug problem. And what I want to do is give an overview of drugs, how they're taken, what the common effects are, and then specifically talk a little bit about chem sex, the chem sex drugs, and some of the consequences we're seeing around chem sex in patients attending our service. Also, at the end, just to talk about where and what kind of help is available. All right, so there are a number of different kinds of classes of drugs, and really, there are lots of different subcategories, but I guess drugs are relevant to people with HIV/AIDS. I should have taken the AIDS out, actually, so that's a head from somewhere else, because we don't very rarely see AIDS, but for HIV are stimulants, particularly methamphetamine, methadrone, and cocaine. Drugs that are depressants, so that sort of calm people down or make them sleepy. That includes drugs like alcohol, or G, or GHB, or GBL. Benzodiazepines, these are drugs like diazepam, Valium, things that people take to help them sleep or calm them down. These are prescription medications usually, and even heroin, I guess, which is an opiate, which is a kind of painkiller, but people inject it or smoke it and it has a depressant effect. And then finally, hallucinogens. Probably hallucinogens are used less overall. We have less experience of our patients having problems with this group of drugs. It's primarily the stimulants and the depressants that seem to cause problems. So how do you take drugs? Well, you can take drugs by injecting them. And amongst gay men, this is sometimes referred to as slamming. And that's basically mixing the drug with some fluid into a syringe and then putting it into a vein, just like a doctor or nurse would take blood from you, but putting it, the drug inside. Intranasally or snorting it, so this is typical of powdered drugs, which are snorted through a straw or a note. Smoking it or vaporizing it. The last picture you can see someone with a crystal meth pipe, which is basically a glass pipe where the crystals are heated to a high temperature. And once they reach a particular temperature, they become liquid. And after that point, they sort of vaporize. And the vapor is then inhaled by the person in order for the drug to be absorbed through the lungs. And finally, some drugs are taken through just taking them by mouth, by oral administration. So you can inject them, snort them up your nose where they get absorbed through the blood vessels of the nose, smoke them through vaporizing them, smoking them like, you know, you can smoke joints and, you know, grass, people smoke that directly, but vaporizing is a more harmful method of taking drugs because you get much higher levels of drugs in your system or orally. Now, when does a person develop a substance use problem? Because drug use is very common in our society. Amongst men, about 10% of heterosexual men use drugs, and amongst gay men, that's three times as much, over 30% of gay men. And actually, attending our service here in South London, about 40% of gay men use recreational drugs, so it's a bit higher compared to heterosexual men in our clinic, where only 10% use drugs. Drug use in women is generally lower than for heterosexual men. I guess a person is said to have a problem potentially with drugs or alcohol if they're using it to medicate emotions or an underlying mental health problem. So if someone's feeling low or depressed, or if they're having feelings of anxiety or feelings of sadness that they can't cope with, and they're using the drugs to mask that or overcome that, that's probably not a healthy motive to use drugs. And a person is said to have a substance use problem is they've developed more dysfunction in one or more areas of their life. And we're going to talk a little bit about the areas of life that can become affected. And just, so if you're someone who's using drugs and want to know, well, do I have a problem or not? And I think there's a useful way of looking at it in terms of assessing if your own life is affected in different ways. And finally, problems can arise if dependence has occurred. Dependence can be physical, so drugs like heroin can cause a physical dependence. So when the drug, after regular use for a few days, you can become hooked on heroin, or your body can become hooked on it. So when you don't have the heroin, you can sneeze, get itches, and your body can feel really bad, and you need to take another fix in order to feel better. So that's physical dependence. Same happens with someone with alcohol or GBL, which we're going to talk about later. And psychological dependence is different. That is more of a mental dependence. So where there's a compulsion, an obsession and a compulsion to have to return to the drugs each time, where there's not necessarily bodily reaction, but a more of a psychological dependence. So these are the life areas. So if you were using drugs, if you were having chem sex and you were wanting to assess yourself to see if you had a problem with it, I guess think about your physical health. Are you continuing to get upset tummies? Are you having problems with repeated STIs or sexual health infections or hepatitis C? Or are there physical health problems going on for you? And then I guess the other thing to look at is mental health. Are bad things happening to your mental health? Are you feeling more anxious? Are you losing your temper more easily? Are you emotionally more labile? Are you feeling flat, or can you not feel anything anymore? Are your emotions different to how they used to be? And that could be an issue. Are there problems with your relationships? For example, if you're in a sexual relationship or a marriage or a long-term relationship of some kind, has your partner noticed that you've changed or complaining that you're acting differently, or is the relationship breaking down? Or relationships with family members, are they under strain because you're cancelling appointments, not turning up for things, and people are getting upset and feeling let down by you? And obviously employment, if you're working and having problems at work because you're going in late or having a disciplinary procedure because of repeated unreliability or sleeping at work, that could become an issue. Some people find housing can become a problem because they're not meeting the demands of their council tax or rents, and that's resulting in homelessness or problems related to housing. Financially, if you're earning lots of money but have nothing to show for it, that could be a problem. Or if you're not earning lots of money and finding that you don't have any money left because you're using it mostly on drugs, that could be an issue. And some of our patients sadly also end up with a problem with the criminal justice, you know, being raided by the police, getting involved in other situations where criminality has occurred. And from our experience, the sorts of things that happen are things like sexual assault, where people have experienced sexual assault, or even perpetrated one, or been accused of perpetrating one, or been in a situation where they've blackmailed, or been blackmailed, or in possession of drugs with intent to supply. So these are all crimes that sometimes people can experience in this sort of situation. So I guess this can be a life check. If you looked at your life areas and one or two of these things, one or more, is affected, then maybe it's worth thinking, maybe I have a problem, maybe I need to talk to someone, maybe I need to explore this a little bit more. So the important thing is to acknowledge that to yourself first, because that's the first step, is to acknowledge to yourself that you could potentially need some help. So I'm going to talk specifically a little bit about chem sex. You know, I've talked about drugs generally, but I'm going to talk about chem sex. Now, chem sex is a term commonly used by gay, bisexual, and other men of sex with men, referring to sex that occurs under the influence of drugs, which can be taken during or immediately preceding a sex session. And basically, it means meeting up with someone and deciding to take drugs together at the same time. It tends to occur in private residences, and groups of people taking drugs to do this are referred to being at a chill out. That's one of the terms that's used. But sometimes it could just be with two people or more, it depends. Geospatial networking applications are used, for those of you who know, that's just a big word for Grindr or one of these apps that people can use to meet other people. And there are lots of different apps that people use in order to meet other people, and sometimes with the specific intent of meeting for chem sex, or meeting to take drugs and have sex. From our experience in the clinic, people talk about taking more risks. People talk about pushing boundaries. People talk about having no limits or becoming someone different when they are under the influence of drugs in a chem sex situation. And some people find where they would have had a boundary where they would never inject, cross that boundary and start to inject. Some people find that I will never use on a Sunday night because I've got to work on Monday, find that they're using on a Sunday night into Monday and not turning up at work. So these are the things where sometimes boundaries can move. Consequences can occur for an individual. So why do people have chem sex? Now, if it was all doom and gloom and trouble at work and no money, nobody'd be doing it. Okay, so I guess for a lot of people, taking drugs is fun, having sex is fun, having chem sex is fun. So that's why people do it. Otherwise, nobody would do it. And people might be curious. People might want adventure in their life. People might want to enhance the intensity of a sexual or a life experience. Also, the presence of drugs helps people be less inhibited. So therefore, the normal shyness, as one's shy or find it difficult to approach someone or feel have body image and they feel it difficult to feel sexy, they might find that with these drugs, they have more connection with other people or other men, and therefore feel that it's something they want to do. Also, I mentioned earlier that gay men use drugs three times as much as straight men. So drug culture is pretty much normalized amongst many gay men or in gay culture. So if you look at some of the parties that only start at 6 a.m, most people wouldn't have gone to bed, woken up early, brushed their teeth and turning up clubbing. I mean, some people did that, but a lot of people have been up all night. And of course, that often is facilitated by stimulant use. And therefore, that culture is normalized. And I guess that's something that I'm curious about as to where that's come from and whether some of that could be challenged in the future, whether this is a healthy attitude or a healthy culture that we need to look at as a community and think about more. There are also other issues like sexuality stigma. So if you grew up in a family where being gay is not acceptable, not right, or gay sex is seen as wrong, And then having to have gay sex can be quite difficult for some people, for some gay men. And therefore, taking drugs can help reduce the inhibitions around that. Having HIV for some people can also be inhibiting. I mean, HIV is a sexually transmitted infection, and for some people, that is a very frightening thing. And if they've been unlucky enough to pick up HIV, they might be really worried about passing it on. But they might worry about themselves being not sexy or not desirable because they've got HIV. And the drugs can help ameliorate those feelings, those negative feelings. And so that's something that we need to also look at with an open mind. Some people might have problems with intimacy, you know, if people have found it difficult to come out, difficult to be themselves, and then using the drugs can help reduce those barriers and engender a sense of intimacy. But obviously, if you're chemically altered, that probably intimacy is a false sense of intimacy rather than true intimacy, which hopefully is something a bit more authentic. So it's a difficult thing to negotiate for different people. And I'm not saying that everybody who uses drugs can't have intimacy, but I'm just saying it gives a sense of intimacy. Some people have true intimacy, but maybe some people have this a feeling of it. And obviously, some people have lack confidence, they're unhappy, and you know, attempts at suicide is six times more common in gay men compared to heterosexual men. So, and mental health disorder such as anxiety or depression is much more common in gay men. And so a proportion of gay men would be using drugs to just manage low mood or anxiety. And for some people, it could be something even more linked to low self-esteem or self-loathing, resulting in a self-destructive or self-harming behavior. So it's a self-harming act using drugs, perhaps destructively, which is effectively a self-harming act. So what I'm saying to you is that if we had six people in a room at a chill out, one person could be curious and being on an adventure, perhaps the healthiest reason to try something new. Somebody's looking for connection because they're finding it difficult. Somebody's doing it just because their friend's doing it. Somebody's doing it because they've got an HIV diagnosis and they want to forget about it and have sex without having to think about it. Some people, another guy there might be worried about intimacy and wanting to feel it. Somebody else might just have low self-confidence and a negative body image. Somebody might be a bit depressed or anxious and needing to run away from that. And somebody else could be self-harming. So the motives are different. It's a complicated area. It's not one size fits all. And I think if you do have chem sex, if you do participate, is to look out for the person who might be depressed. Look out for the person might need your support in different ways, because not everyone there is on a happy journey or a healthy journey potentially. So it's something to look at and work together and support each other. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the drugs. I'm going to go quite quickly through this. And really, methadrone is one of the commonly used chemsex drugs, and it's a cathinone. It's a stimulant. It's similar to amphetamine or cocaine. It makes people feel awake, alive. It can lead to a high body temperature. It's sometimes used in a clubbing context and often used to stay awake, to feel sexually aroused. If it's used in excessively, it can lead to visual hallucinations, staying awake for days, which can then result in psychosis. So it's something to watch. And if you've got heart disease or a problem with heart disease, it's probably not good to use drugs that increase your heart rate because it puts an additional strain on it. And what about crystal methamphetamine? And with methadone, people can snort it, swallow it. Sometimes even people booty bump it, which is mix it with water and put it into the rectum. As with crystal meth, that's the other thing some people do. So what is crystal meth, often referred to as Tina or ice? It's a powerful amphetamine. It's often smoked through a glass pipe, but sometimes it's injected in some people. And psychological dependence with crystal meth is very strong. And I'm going to show you a graph on this in a minute to show how powerful it is. And some people, and so in our clinic, and people have been, say, slamming or injecting crystal meth, and they've been awake for 3-4 days, and they've come for PEP, or they've come with a sexual health problem. Many of them, up to a quarter of them, are psychotic or experiencing a psychosis at presentation. That's when they might be hearing voices or they might be feeling paranoid. And so it can be quite frightening when taken large amounts for long periods of time. There are well-described harms related to crystal meth because of its powerful, the way it acts so powerfully that people feel the need to go back to do it each time in order to feel good, so kind of psychological dependence. And for some people where use has been excessive or uncontrolled or where the compulsion to go back to it has been very severe, there have even been criminal justice consequences. Some of the crimes we talked about that patients sometimes unwittingly commit. I know many of my patients have ended up doing stuff that I know that it's not in their nature, you know, but they have ended up committing crimes, and it's something that we do see sometimes. And that can be difficult for an individual, you know, acting outside how they would normally because they've been high. G is an important drug to understand. It's probably an important one because there's a recent article published earlier this year that cites increasing G deaths in London. And it's probably probably a major cause of death in gay men in London at the moment. It's a powerful sedative. Initially it stimulates and then it sedates with small volumes. So measuring the amount people take, not taking too much together, not mixing it with alcohol and or other sedatives is really important. And the thing with G is that when people go over or go under on G, it's because they've had just a little too much and they actually go to sleep and they go into a coma. And they can stop breathing, and that can be very serious for a person. And I've mentioned that. And here at St. George's, we're beginning to look at how we can support people who present with an overdose with G to accident, emergency, or intensive care. And we're going to try and provide more sexual health support for people in those circumstances, and maybe some chem sex support if they need it. I need to talk about dependence. So just like alcohol, if you take G, you can become hooked on it. And this involves taking 1 or 2 mils of G every hour, sometimes even every half an hour, depending on how hooked you are on it, but certainly every few hours. And some people are needing to wake up through the night to take G. And these people who are physically dependent, where if they stop, they can get withdrawals, need professional help if they want to stop. So it's dangerous just to stop your G in that situation. And the G withdrawal syndrome, so if you're hooked on G, which can occur, It's most likely to occur if you're using it to help you sleep. So if you've been up 4 days on crystal meth and then you decided to whack G to help you to sleep, and then you feel very anxious when you wake up and you take more to calm your nerves, and then an individual can become hooked on G. So and if you are hooked on G and been taking it for some time regularly, it's dangerous to stop abruptly. Seek a professional help either to your local drug services, a gay-friendly drug service in central London, such as Antidote, or even approach your sexual health clinic for advice on where you best get that help. And it can be severe and life-threatening if you stop G suddenly and abruptly if you're hooked on it. It can lead to delirium, feeling delirious, an agitated psychosis, severe anxiety, insomnia, feeling terribly afraid. So it's a difficult one. It's a difficult condition, difficult place to be. So this is some information from Antidote. I mean, if we look in 2005, 179 clients. In 2013, now 758 clients. And I can tell you the numbers continue to go up. And if we look at G-related problems, 2 to 3%, 2% in 2005, up to 46%, three patients to 334, crystal meth from 0 patients to 373, and methadone from 0 to 461 seeking help through Antidote. So these are people voluntarily going seeking help with a drug problem, and these are the chemsex drugs, and numbers of people seeking help is going up. So good to access services if you feel you need it, and you're not alone, because there are other people also needing help and seeking help and getting it. Now, I wanted to talk about this, and I'm going to just draw this on this flip chart over here, and really is to look at the reaction with crystal meth. So if we crystal meth acts on the dopamine receptors of the brain. So if you have a pleasurable experience, such as eating a nice meal or having a fruit salad or walking a lovely, beautiful puppy dog, you might get a little dopamine release in your brain, and it's a lovely, pleasurable experience. However, if you use a stimulant drug such as crystal meth or cocaine or methadone, you have a more enhanced experience of that pleasurable experience. So for methadone or cocaine, and the curve for crystal meth beats the lot. Okay, so officially with crystal meth, you get a very, very strong sense of well-being, feeling all powerful and feeling absolutely wonderful. The difficulty is that if you feel that great, suddenly having a lovely puppy dog to walk is really quite boring in comparison. And that's what people find, is that they want to go back to this because all of this is really boring compared to this. And it's the same with people who initially maybe snort it, then they start to smoke it or vaporize it, and then they might inject it, and then it's hard to go back because the lesser amount is less stimulating and less interesting. And the other thing I wanted to talk about is what happens to someone who's habitually using drugs like crystal meth, is a change can occur. So over time, you might have a real great high with crystal meth. It feels really good, but you then get a come down. And if you take the same amount, it's not as good, and you get a bigger come down. And then you inject it to meet the same height, and you get another come down. And then you keep trying, but it never quite goes up to where it was. And if my average mood was here to start off with, and I'm doing these drugs habitually, you can see my average mood used to be here. My average mood is now going down. Okay? It's okay. So the average mood goes down with habitual users. And so if you've been using crystal meth for a long time and you're finding it difficult to stop, don't be surprised, because part of what's driving you is... Okay, so part of what's driving you is the fact your mood is going down and your brain's... That's okay. And your brain's just, wanting to be feeling stimulated. Okay, we've got a phone going. That's okay. That's part of life. That's part of a live broadcast, isn't it? We get phones going occasionally. See, it's evidence we've got a full audience here today. Okay, so does that make sense to everyone? That sort of average mood going down. So what can happen is a preoccupation, a binge intoxication, a negative withdrawal effect is the cycle. So if you're thinking about it, you do it, and then you have this negative effect, then you get preoccupied again, you use it again, and this is the circle that people find themselves in. But the problem with the circle with these kind of stimulant drugs is that you don't stay like this, because it's going down. The spring, it's like a spiral that's going downwards, okay? And I guess that's the definition of addiction, continuing to repeatedly do something despite worse and worse things happening, worse and worse consequences, negative health, negative psychological, is a person can't escape it, finding it difficult to escape it. So what did we find in our study? Colleagues here at St. George's, we looked at people having chemsex, and we found that chem sex use was much higher in HIV-positive men compared to HIV-negative men. So amongst patients participating in chem sex, 34.5% were HIV-positive versus only 7% of those not having chem sex were HIV-positive. So certainly people with HIV are more likely to be participating in chem sex. And that it could be that people with HIV may have been more likely to take drugs before they became HIV positive, and maybe that contributed. It could be that the HIV diagnosis itself leads to increased drug use, and there's evidence for that. Or it can be a mixture of the both. We also know that mental health problems, we heard in last week's presentation, such as depression, more common in people with HIV, and therefore the needing to want to fix that maybe with recreational drugs might be higher. So it's a complex area with lots of interactions of different factors. So, and I guess that's as a clinic, we want to support and understand patients through that. We also found in our gay men participating in chem sex, they were more likely to drink more heavily, more likely to inject, more likely to pay or sell sex, and more likely to have group sex or sex potentially that could cause trauma. And if you were HIV negative and having chem sex, you're more likely to have an HIV positive partner or a hepatitis discordant partner. So a mixture of different factors. And we also found those disclosing chem sex were much more likely to have an STI, an erectile STI, so much more likely to have an infection from sex. So maybe because of more frequent partner change, maybe because of the group sex, or maybe because the sex goes on for longer and therefore bugs can get transmitted more easily. So lots, again, complicated reasons why this could happen. If you're HIV positive and participating in chem sex, there are important issues to think about. So if you are going for more than 24 hours, you know, have you got plans to take your medication? If you're going away to have your chem sex, have you taken enough medication for 2 days or 3 days, depending on how long you're going away for? And also in our clinic, sometimes we've seen some patients who are heavily using drugs, such as crystal meth, are lost to follow-up. So we lose them and we have to chase them up to bring them back, to get them back on medication. But also remember, if you're taking drug stimulants, cocaine, crystal meth, they tend to be appetite suppressants, so people tend not to eat. And if you're taking a drug such as Abiplera that needs you to eat, then you might get lower drug levels. And sometimes people who are participating in chem sex might get dehydrated if they're not drinking enough fluids, not eating, much more likely to suffer from upset stomachs, vomiting and diarrhea, and all of this might increase side effects experienced from drugs, but also maybe reduce the amount of drugs absorbed into the system. And the other really important thing to bear in mind, if you're on a ritonavir or norvir, or you're on cobicistat in your medication, it's part of your combination, it can increase the effects of drugs such as MDMA or crystal meth, or particularly drugs like a sedative such as benzodiazepine. So you've got to be really careful when you're using recreational drugs with your antiretrovirals to maybe talk to your doctor or nurse or pharmacist to check through the interaction so that you know that you don't come to unwittingly to any harm. So we've talked about how things present, how people present, and I'm going to talk about some of the negative consequences related to chemsex. So yes, if you're curious and having an adventure, great, look after yourself, reduce the harms. But if you've got a low mood or there are consequences happening, if you're avoiding emotions, then those people may be vulnerable to developing addiction or or problematic drug use. And, you know, with problematic drug use, we have seen people with increased anxiety, depression, or psychosis up here on the top left, more suicide attempts, accidental overdose requiring intensive care hospital treatment. We've got currently an outbreak of hepatitis A in London and also acute hepatitis C. Bacteria in the blood from injecting fluid that's dirty or got bacteria in it can make things worse. STIs. HIV infection itself can be increased with chem sex, and trauma to the rectum, and also teeth problems or skin infections. So lots of different health consequences, or mental health and physical consequences. And really, what I wanted to show is that for many people, there are minimal health or social or psychological impacts. So they are healthy, they're well, with few impacts. And then for some people, remember the different areas of life that can be affected. They may have STIs, financial, finer, or work-related problems. They may be emotionally labile, feeling up and down. For some people, they may have more serious health problems, more serious STIs, relationship breakdown with family, friends, partners, a loss of job, more serious mental health hospital admissions, etc., and maybe even experience non-consensual or non-volitional sex, so sex that's occurred when they haven't fully consented to it. And we are seeing some people, particularly if they've gone under on G, having sex that they didn't consent to. And finally, in worst case scenario, we also do an outreach clinic in Wandsworth Prison, and some people have been imprisoned or developed chronic mental health problems. And sadly, some people have even died just from a drug overdose or from suicide linked to a drug problem. So really, life is an onion, and sometimes we can see the person who's lost their job or who's picked up HIV or who's just been diagnosed with hepatitis C on the outside as the problem. But if we dig layer by layer deeper, there might be a problem with chem sex or drug use, which might be masking a depression or anxiety, which might be masking low self-esteem, which might in turn be linked to stigma, whether it's HIV, sexuality, or other stigma and shame. So it's something that is actually quite complicated and quite deep. And the person who's using the drugs or develop experience the consequences might not even be in touch with what's going on internally. And we'd like to work with those patients as appropriate to help them through things. So if you're using recreational drugs and you're worried you have a problem, can you tell your doctor or nurse, is it safe to do so? 100% yes, because we're here to look after your health. We're not here to ring the police or get you into trouble. We're here to protect you and to look after you. And so we see a drug use or a drug problem as a health problem. We don't see it as a criminal justice problem. So we see if you had a chem sex problem or a drug problem, there's something that as a health issue rather than a criminal justice issue. That's how we approach it. So provided that you tell us you're not going to harm yourself or you're not going to harm anyone else, there's nobody to talk to other than you and to support you. And really, if we need to talk to your GP or the local drug services, we always talk to you first. We don't breach your confidentiality without talking to you first. In exceptional circumstances, if we are worried for your safety, we might need to talk to your GP. But in most cases, you know, it's between us. And I think that's something that people need to be aware of. And what is the treatment? So there is treatment available. There's very little evidence base for what works best for chem sex. But really, if we look at drug treatments overall, they can be individualized. So it's not like one size fits all. I think it's important to recognize what the positive things drugs are giving you as well as the negative impacts, so you can weigh the pros and cons. Some people prefer being totally abstinent. Other people want to reduce the amount they use or how they use drugs. So there's an abstinence versus non-abstinence. And it's for you to decide what you want. Try one thing out, try the other thing out. It's not written in sense. Nobody's going to tell you what you have to do. There are harm reduction initiatives, like teaching you how to inject safely if you're injecting, how to measure your G safely if that's necessary. And we can go through that in detail. So if you can talk to your drug worker or even come to the clinic and talk to your health advisor, we can give you more information. And really, the cornerstone of treatment is, first of all, to make sure there is an underlying mental health problem that needs treatment and that can be treated. To think about individual psychotherapy or group psychotherapy. There are workshops available through groups, through Antidote, SWAP, various programs that are running. But if you want to attend self-help groups, you can attend Smart Recovery or Narcotics Anonymous. There's even a Crystal Meth Anonymous now where you can attend in groups and support other people trying to do the same thing as you, which is reduce the amount of drugs or stop the amount of drugs you're taking. So the take-home message is recreational drug use in HIV is common. Chemsex is a specific form of drug use with sex amongst gay men. There are harms related, particularly if there's a loss of control in the amount and the duration of drug use or risk-taking behaviors when high. The motive for drug use is important, so why are you doing it? And understanding why you're doing it is really important. And I have to say that from my experience of working in this clinic, sometimes people don't really know why they're doing it. So talking about it helps. Then you can work it out, talking to us and talking to the health advisors, the counselors, so you work out why you are doing it. Because it's not up to us to tell you why you're doing it, it's up to you to work it out. And finally, recognize that psychological and that there is psychological dependence for some of these drugs, and there's physical dependence, and you can be supported with that. And treatment is available for those with a drug and a chem sex problem, so don't feel afraid or worried or anxious about asking or involving us. Thank you.